This episode of Tailgate Talks is brought to you by Blanca. Tune in live to interact with the hosts on Wednesday nights, 6:30 Central, at www.twitch.tv/BlancaOG. Hope you enjoy the show.
All right, guys, here we are, week 34, episode 34. We have not missed a single week for you guys. We love putting this on for y'all, but we do need y'all's help, as always. Make sure, if you're not, subscribe to the podcast on Spotify or iTunes. If it is on iTunes, make sure you give us that five-star rating, drop us a review in the comment section below, and help us grow this show as much as we can so we can put on a good show for you for years to come. But if you haven't already as well, make sure you give us a follow on Twitter at tailgate_talks. We are also on Instagram and Facebook. But more importantly, recently, I guess if you want to look at our one of our focus shifts recently has been YouTube. We've been putting a lot of content out there. So make sure you do look us up on YouTube, Tailgate Talks or Tailgate Talks Podcast. You can find it. Just type that into the search menu. And Give us a subscribe there. Ring the bell. You know, we've been having some fun making the short videos for you guys. And, you know, we understand that sometimes you don't always have a bunch of time to listen to the full episode. I know we talk for about an hour to an hour and a half sometimes. So we have some shorts out for you guys on YouTube. As far as our personal accounts go, make sure if you want to give Dustin a personal follow, you can follow him at DustinWimmer22. Brooks, you can follow him at Calvin B. Barrett, and me, you can find me at Blanca, where the L is a 1. And lastly, if you have any sort of suggestions for the podcast, give us a shout out over at our email, which is tailgatetalkspod@gmail.com. Send us your thoughts or questions, ask us anything you want to know or hear on the show, or if you have any sort of anything you want to reach us out to us about that you don't want to hit us up on the socials or in DMs or anything like that. So with all that out of the way, we got plenty for to talk with y'all today. Mostly we have no NFL for once. Finally, nothing of importance happened. 1 week. We just needed one week from it. Cause it was just every single week. Dustin was over here like, dude, I'm tired of this. We're done. We needed a break from this. But we do have plenty of Texas Tech news for y'all. Obviously, the NBA playoffs have been going off. This has been fantastic. So, without further ado, let's jump into Club Red. All right. So, Club Red for the week. We got a good episode for you guys. Dustin, you might need to unmute yourself if you want to join in on the talk. Just throwing it out there.
No help.
You're the one that muted me. I'm just saying.
I know, because I always catch background noise in the opener, and I had to start doing it again.
I blame you.
It's my fault for y'all's background noise? No, it's not. So, Big 12 tournament to kick it off. We'll start the discussion on that. Obviously, nobody really I don't put any big value in the Big 12 tournament. It was kind of a good way to get some games, see maybe a couple of decent teams in there, and we ended up losing to TCU in the second round. TCU ended up winning the whole thing. But Dustin, any thoughts on the Big 12 tournament or championship?
Well, I mean, we had a good showing first game against Baylor. We came out and crushed them. And then our second game against TCU got postponed. So it really screwed us on the schedule. We had to play back-to-back games on Friday. So once we lost to TCU, we had to turn around and play Kansas State, and we just didn't show up for that one either. So TCU kind of rolled through our side of the schedule after that and went on to win the whole thing. Kind of sucked just having to – play two games in a row on Friday after being ready Thursday. So that really sucked and kind of screwed things up, but not enough, luckily.
Right. Very, very true. And kind of a main fact to take away from all this, and we'll dive further into it later, obviously, but we kept a top eight seed, which means we kept a regional tournament. Brooks, thoughts on the Big 12 championship?
Nah, I just wish we would have left that with a little bit of a better taste in our mouths, but yeah. You know, you kind of sucked it up there on that last day where you just couldn't, you know, hit the ball and you couldn't keep the other team from scoring. So not the way you would like to go into the tournament, but we've done this many times before. So I guess it doesn't scare me all that much. So
I feel like even our best teams have never put a big stock into the Big 12 tournament, like in college or in basketball. I mean, and in baseball, like, we don't really care about this. The goal is, and always will be, to win a national championship or get as close to it as we can with a shot at every single game. So, J-Jack Joker, welcome to the chat. Welcome to the tailgate. Appreciate you guys dropping in as always. So moving on to the next thing that we're actually worried about, which is the start of the NCAA tournament, right? And this is where the big bucks matter. This is where our games really do need to be on point. And luckily, again, we're hosting another regional. We got the eighth overall seed, so we snuck in there, or barely didn't get kicked out of hosting it. Awesome job there to our guys all year. But to kick this off, we have a stat for the week early in the show for you guys. Dustin's going to give you what do you got for this week?
Take that for data.
Yeah, so Tech baseball held on, kept a top eight national seed. So that means if we can win regionals, we will host the super regionals, which reason that's important. So this is our fourth time in five seasons to have a top eight national seed. And the reason I think that's important is because three out of the 4 years that we have made it to Omaha, we have hosted a super regional. So very important to have that home field advantage, not only for these first two rounds, in the set of games, but for that next set when you're playing possibly a much larger, bigger opponent in what's basically like the Sweet 16 of college baseball. You can have a home series for that and a trip to Omaha. So huge for those guys to have the top eight national seed for the fourth time in 5 years.
You got to take that win. Brooks, what's your thoughts on gaining the regional, on us getting the eighth seed, on our bracket for this regional? What are you thinking so far going into this?
Yeah, so we knew we were going to be a regional host. The only thing we didn't know going into Monday was whether we were going to be a national seed or not. I think a lot of us thought we might slip out of the top eight after our performance at the Big 12 tournament, because a lot of the rankings had us, you know, 10th or 11th or somewhere in that range. And so I think a lot of us were a little bit surprised when it came through that we were the eighth seed. There was a little backlash about it with some baseball writers thinking that Notre Dame should have got in as an eighth seed because they have a better record than we do. But Notre Dame played high school teams all year, and we played teams at the top. Like we played Arkansas, Mississippi State, Texas, TCU. Four of those teams are national seeds. So we've had our fair share of competitive series throughout the year, and we won a lot of those competitive series. So I think it's deserving.
I think it also helped that we kind of have a very recent history of hosting, selling out, being a good host, all that kind of factored into it. I think a little bit.
Maybe. Might have pushed the needle a little bit, because we do have the facility and the city to be able to support a tournament like this. So maybe. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't think that has anything to do with it. I just think our play this year has been, you know, we played a strong schedule. Mm-hmm. We've been competitive all year. Sure, we've face our fair share of injuries, but what we've been able to do with that has been, I think, respected. And yeah, I think it does leave a, you know, that thought in their head that we've been hosting every single year and we've been in the College World Series. Yeah. And maybe that has a little bit, but I think overall it's your play and what you did on the field that earned you this spot. And, you know, when you play the best teams, when you play the best, all the best teams, you're going to, that's going to help you out.
Like a bit of like a legacy vote kind of thing. Like we've been in it for like we're going to be, and obviously with this Tadlock extension on their, you know, lifelong extension on his contract, we're going to be in the college baseball discussion for years to come. Like I'm not really worried that he's not going to be able to recruit, and so like maybe it's just kind of finally starting to be like, okay, you know what I'm thinking? It might be like, it's like whenever UT gets a stupidly high ranking at the start of every football season for no reason. I feel like we've almost crossed that path of like people know that we like have a bit of a national respect, I guess. I don't know.
I mean,
because we had good play, maybe, but
we've
just
earned it. We've earned it.
Yeah.
But they don't give us that ranking, and then we shit the bed. They give us that ranking, and then we make the College World Series. So I think it's a little bit different. But I get what you're trying to say. Yeah,
like I'm not saying we're shit. I'm just saying like there's a bit of national recognition now to Texas Tech baseball. It's not just, oh, we went you know 40-0 or something like that. Like no. We're an established program, is all.
Yeah.
So. First game going to be on Friday, this Friday, actually, both sets of games. 11 a.m. is going to be the first game. We're going up against Army. The next game will be on Saturday after that, depending on who wins the first two. Obviously, we do expect a win out of that game. Anything that y'all would maybe be scared of throughout this first part of the regional with any of these other three teams? Brooks.
Well, let's just kind of take a look at who's in the regional. We haven't mentioned them yet, so let's do that. Our team that we're playing Friday, of course, is Army.
Yep.
They come in as the 4 seed, a 28-23 overall record. And then the 2 seed, the UCLA Bruins, 35-18, and North Carolina Tar Heels at 27-25. From what I've seen, it was a little bit of a shock that North Carolina had made the tournament. They were kind of one of those bubble teams that snuck in. But UCLA has a pretty identical record to you. A friend of ours texted us a little bit before we got on. UCLA has the same odds to win the national championship as we do. Really? So I don't know what that says.
If they have a guy at super good and coming back from injury or what the case is, but apparently, yeah, they got something. They're coming in pretty strong, I guess.
I mean, that's a pretty good
record. I've seen that they have a really good pitcher who's lost one game on the year. I would imagine they throw him against, you know, if they win, I imagine that they try to throw him game two. A lot of teams try to throw their best pitcher in the second game because it's either you're facing elimination or your chance to, you know, secure a spot in the championship of the regional. And then I think they have a really good, I think we're going to have two of the best shortstops in the country here over the weekend. I think they have a really, really good first round prospect shortstop is what I've seen.
I mean, what'd you say the record was? 30-18?
35-18.
That's pretty
while
good.
We sit at we're 36-15, so
yeah, that's literally right on our heels.
Solid.
Good. I don't know what their level of competition was in the Pac-12. I know the Pac-12 was kind of down this year, but and I don't really know who they played non-con.
Yeah, but still, I mean, you got to respect the amount of wins there. So I think it's going to be a good tournament.
There's a team to watch out for. It's definitely them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's what it's sounding like. So, expectations for Texas Tech in this postseason, because already opening out of the gates, UCLA is going to be a bit of a speed bump going on to the Super Regionals. Brooks, what are your expectations for us here? I mean, do you expect to just have a easy trip back to the College World Series, or is there going to be kind of some speed bumps along the way that really kind of slowed down that confidence?
It's tough to say. So we said it all year. This team has been very inconsistent. You don't know what you're getting each and every weekend from them. You're going to beat Texas at Texas, but you're going to lose at home to Baylor. Just things like that that have been frustrating throughout the season. We haven't had a complete weekend in forever. So I really feel like this is a team that's either going to get bounced in regionals or they're going to go to the College World Series. Because in a three-game series, I feel pretty comfortable saying that I think we can take two out of three from somebody in the Supers. I just am curious how it's going to be if we have to play like a fourth game in the regionals or if we have to battle back. I just haven't been able to trust our pitching enough. So that makes me nervous. So that's kind of how I see it. I either see us not making it out of the regionals or I see us making a trip back to College World Series, because I'll take whoever we can play in a series. but if we have to, go, you know, four games this weekend, it makes me a little nervous who's going to throw that fourth game.
Yeah, it sucked going four games for sure. So hopefully we can handle things in just three games and get out of there and go to the next round. But that's where I see us maybe having a big hiccup, because Stanford, who in D1 baseball is ranked seventh, we're ranked ninth. I mean, that doesn't matter anymore, but they're right there with us. They would be meeting us here for that next round of Supers. So that'd be a really tough matchup in game. So handle business this weekend. Let's go into the weekend with a win. Next weekend, come back. Hopefully, maybe Stanford gets upset and we got to play somebody else. That'd be kind of nice, but we never get the breaks.
Nope.
But, yeah, it's Omaha or bust. I mean, even with this team that has all the injuries, I mean, this is probably Tim Tadlock's best coaching I think he's ever done, because of all the injuries and question marks and unproven guys that we've had. But it's still – the expectations are still as high as ever. So it's Omaha or nothing.
Yeah, I still agree that that's the expectation. I feel like I'm a little more nervous about it this year.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, Arlie, you were muted.
Right.
There,
yeah, so. Yeah. It was fine. I
mute yourself.
I know. I mute myself just to cut down background noise. But like I'm with you on that, Dustin. I really do feel like the especially with last season getting canceled and extra players being in here and basically having 80 million probably about 80 backup pitchers. Just having such a large roster, I think I really do feel the same. I really do feel like we need to make it to Omaha. I feel like that's where that needs to be our goal. And anything short of that is going to be a disappointment. Realistically, can we make it? Yeah, I do. I do think so. I think our starting pitching's solid enough. And our bats, if they get hot, get hot enough to beat any team in college baseball. And so I think it's just going to come down to that closeout pitching rotation, if they can keep whoever's the opposition off the scoreboard. But
and let's just hope we've been saving our best for the last. And we've seen our teams do that plenty of times before. So,
next thing, let's go ahead and jump over to the next topic.
Well, hey, if you're in Lubbock, get out there and support them this weekend.
Yeah. Absolutely.
I'll be there.
Friday.
Drink a lot of Ultras. Yes. Get some good tailgating in.
Had
good times.
Wear your Tailgate Talks t-shirt out there. If you happen to wear one or have one, we've given out what? We've given out like 30, 40? We've given out
probably something like that.
Quite a few. We've given out quite a few of those. But yeah, the game will be on Friday. It is an 11 a.m. game. It's going to be – is it 11 a.m. or 10 a.m.?
11 a.m.
Yeah. It's 11 a.m. game. Sorry, I wasn't sure if it changed it to Central. It's going to be broadcast on ESPNU, but obviously we're going to be out there at the Dan Law all weekend. So make sure you go out there and support. First game's Friday at 11. If we move on, next round will be Saturday. The game time, not posted on this detail. But anyways, so jumping forward to the next topic for Texas Tech. Very cool little topic. Brooks, do you want to go into full explanation as to what this is? You want me to describe it as best I know it?
I mean, I've got the... basically what they tweeted out here, beyond verified, they announced it Monday morning. It's a new program, an NIL program, which is name, image, and likeness. and it launches in June, and it provides an industry-leading tools for student athletes to build and grow their name, image, and likeness while also learning how to protect their business assets. It is kind of a groundbreaking program for that Tech is doing here. We all, if you're paying attention to sports at all over the last several years, we've known that the name and likeness thing has been big. That's why you don't have NCAA football video games. Mm-hmm. But these laws are coming into play. NCAA is trying to help these players make a little bit off of their name and image and likeness. And so Tech implementing this program is a pretty big deal, and it's going to help student athletes create a brand, learn how to work with that brand, and learn how to protect that brand and make it, you know, something valuable. We've seen several of our athletes, you know, Patrick Mahomes comes to mind the most, but you know, we all knew about him here, but he's got himself a pretty dang good brand, and he's done pretty well with his professional career in that line, with his Twitter, with his various business ventures that he's already doing. So if, you know, set a good base for these athletes, help them benefit from themselves and their time here at Tech, and set them up for a future. Pretty cool.
I think it's phenomenal. I'm actually, as I was reading this, I was getting more and more excited because it's a step in the right direction for college athletes, which the NCAA and the universities are making a lot of money off of them. And so this is a step in the right direction, in my opinion, towards them kind of getting, I guess, outside of, you know, free education, financially somehow getting compensated for their efforts on the field, whatever their sport is. And so I love this. As soon as you sent that or posted that in the show notes for today, I read through it and was like, this is very, very good step for any college athlete going forward. And I don't know, Dustin, any thoughts on the Beyond Verified program?
Now, y'all nailed it. A lot of good things for future student athletes, and one makes Tech look really good to try to help them out. And I see this being one of many institutions to start rolling out these kind of things for student athletes, because if not, you're going to be behind.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
that's going to start to be a recruiting tool against you if you don't have it. So I think we are one of many that's going to come out, especially this summer when a lot of new programs and updates to facilities and programs and all that comes out. So look for a lot more institutions to do this.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
I think it's the right step. I'm loving it. And do y'all know if we're the first one to kind of implement something like this exactly? Or because I know it's new, it's a new ruling, right?
It's a new ruling. And, you know, I don't think it's actually taken place yet. So we are kind of the first, from what I've seen, we're the first school to do this.
Cool.
And I think, like Dustin said, we're trying to get ahead of it. If you read the article about it, they've been working on it since like 2018.
Yeah.
So they put a lot of time and effort into this. And so I just think it's neat. It's definitely going to be a recruiting advantage here for a little bit, but before everybody else catches up to us. But, you know, it's innovative, it's forward thinking, and it benefits the athletes. And they are the ones that put their blood, sweat, and tears out there on the line for us. So I think it's cool.
Yeah, 100% agree with that. I think I do really feel like student athletes, and especially because they don't, most of them, you know, what is it, like maybe 5% that goes actually pro, maybe?
No, not even that many.
Right? It's a disappointingly low percentage that goes low. And so like, For them to be compensated like this this is minimal because it's just literally teaching them to use their name and create a social media account and not basically get screwed over. But it's the right step. It's the right step, and it needed to happen a long time ago. So that is the Texas Tech Beyond Verified that we're discussing. Next topic is just kind of a brief catch up with Texas Tech basketball. Chandler Jacobs, who was originally with Dallas Baptist, right? who was a Texas Tech commit for this upcoming season, has decommitted, and I believe I asked one of you guys earlier, but it was to Colorado? Is it Boulder?
Colorado State.
Okay. I don't want to wish him the best of luck. I don't, you know, part of me though, like it is like with how many good people we've been bringing in, I'm not too surprised either. Cause we've brought in a lot of talent. We've brought in I'm actually really looking forward to this roster that we have going. And so like, I'm not too surprised to start seeing at least one person drop out because he might end up sitting the bench too much.
Yeah, that's basically what it was. I think he was starting to get unhappy with all the other kind of combo guards we were bringing in, and that was going to cut into his playing time.
Oh, yeah.
Minute stats, all that good stuff, and he just, I guess, didn't want to be here anymore. And
his loss.
Mark Adams sees that as a no-win situation.
Yeah.
And at this point, it's not a huge loss because you've built the roster up enough and have filled those holes, especially at guard at that position. So this isn't a huge like loss to your program. Of course you'd rather have him here and want to be here than not. So I think it's a mutual, like, hey, you don't want to be here. It's going to be a bad time if you are.
Yeah.
Locker room cancer type situation. So let him go. And if he wants to go to a very subpar type program rather than a Big 12 type program.
He maybe just wants to be the big fish in a small pond.
Yeah, what it tells me is that he's more about making his numbers look good than about winning. And if that's his mentality, then get all the way out of here and go play basketball at Colorado State. Like, I mean, I think me and Dustin were kind of talking about it over the weekend when the news kind of broke and we were like, why do you think? And, you know, it's just it's kind of selfish.
Yep.
But, you know, at the same time, earlier when this happened, if we knew we were going to lose him, I think we would have both kind of panicked a little bit. But since we've seen all the recruits come in and seen this roster take shape, it's not really like a panic button that you would hit anymore. It's like, all right, I think we've got some talent at the guard position. We got a lot of 6'6 guys, like we mentioned. Got a lot of guys who can put the ball in the basket. So I don't think you're really losing much. And yeah, if his mentality is I need my playing time, then, you know, go find it at the meaningless Rams, you know, so whatever. Get out of here.
Yeah, that's basically it. He's not here for the team and he's just looking out for himself. And I that's his right too. I mean, good. Yeah. Let him go be the big fish in the small pond and throw up maybe 25 points a game, and maybe it'll be better for him. I don't know, but he's no longer under our roof, and so I no longer care. I think that kind of wraps up the Club Red segment for today. Normally, at this point in the episode, is where we would kick it over to Dustin for the NFL, but this week has all been speculation and minor stories. Literally, nothing big to come out of the NFL. Nothing that's newsworthy. So here we're gonna go ahead and kick this over to Brooks here in a second, and we're going to be talking about the NBA playoffs. The Eastern Conference kind of starting to wrap up. Western Conference doing the same thing. A couple of those games going on right now. This is Tailgate Talks NBA Talk. All right, Brooks, so take the helm. How are we doing so far?
Yes, so we are wrapping up first round in the NBA playoffs. By this time next week, we'll be completely into the second round of the NBA playoffs. Most of our Eastern Conference rounds are kind of taking shape here. We've had two of them decided, so we'll start off with those. We have the Milwaukee Bucks, who swept the Miami Heat.
Broom.
The Miami Heat leave the NBA playoffs as the only team in this year's playoffs to not win a single game. The former Eastern Conference champions came into the season with high hopes and, you know, fell pretty far from those expectations that I think they had built. Jimmy Butler said, just get me to the playoffs, and they did, and Jimmy Butler did not do anything in the playoffs.
Nope.
The Milwaukee Bucks, however, have seemingly gone up a level. dispatching of the Heat in four quick, easy games. And so that leaves us kind of wondering what goes on with the Heat this offseason and where do they go from here? Dustin, you picked the Heat in your win pool teams. What do they got to do to make you pick them again next year?
They got to blow it up because obviously they showed who they were. I think as a thing of the Heat were not as good as they thought and the Bucks were way better than everybody else thought. And so that makes me seem like the Heat are far away from any kind of championship team. So I would look with that kind of organization and how they've been in the past, I would look for them to get aggressive this offseason. But obviously this kind of team is not it.
Dustin says, blow it up. Blow it up, Pat Riley. Arlie, where you lie with the Heat this season?
So if you're going to have success in any major sport, you need to be constantly trying to improve. And the Milwaukee Bucks did that over the offseason. They did that over this season. And the Miami Heat threw out the same thing, thinking that they were going to get the same results. And they didn't. They have a way too young of a roster with too many distractions on the team. And this was kind of predictable, in my opinion. I was hoping, because the Miami Heat had such a good outing last season, that this would be a better, kind of little bit more drawn out series, not a full sweep. But the Bucks got better in the offseason, and the Heat didn't. And this is the end result.
Yeah, I think where the Heat were a little misguided is I think they thought Tyler Hero was a projected star in the league. And while he was still going to be a couple years away from hitting that, I think they saw what he did last year and thought he would probably get better. And he didn't. Bam Adebayo, what we saw from him last year, they assumed he was going to get better, and he didn't. Jimmy Butler was hurt and didn't perform to the way he did last year. So maybe this is kind of a bubble anomaly team. Maybe that environment really did help them, and maybe this is who they really are. I know for a fact that they had a chance at James Harden, and I wonder how much they regret not throwing Tyler Hero at him, that because they thought Tyler Hero was untouchable, or Duncan Robinson was untouchable. These guys that they kind of put at this level, who clearly you would hand them over to the Rockets now for James Harden like that.
Yeah.
So just kind of the opportunity was there, and you know, you missed out on it. And it got us to our next team that advanced last night after the gentleman sweep of the Boston Celtics. Jason Tatum did have a 50-point game that kept the Nets from completely dismantling of the Celtics. But in the end all be all, the Celtics are out. The Nets prevail. Took them one extra game, but we saw the big three perform for the longest stretch that we've seen them play for this season. Dustin, you call them your Nets. What are your thoughts after the first round with them?
They're looking like the best team in the league right now. Everybody else is getting hurt. Everybody's stars are getting hurt. And my Nets are getting healthy and starting to roll. So I would look for them to try to keep it up. Now they're going to get some rest, almost a week off, and go into the second round strong. So they're looking good. I want to talk about the team that lost this. So come back on that.
Yeah. So before we go into getting into the second round and stuff like that, we just talked about the Heat's fallout. Well, the Celtics fallout didn't last a day. Didn't last 24 hours after their loss. News broke this morning. If you're unaware, Danny Ainge, their president of basketball operations, been there since 2004, orchestrated some great trades, some great draft picks over the years. He decides to step down. And on top of that, Brad Stevens decides to step down as head coach and take over Danny Ainge's position. So the Celtics are without their president of basketball operations, who found them Jason Tatum, who found them Jaylen Brown. And now they're without their head coach for the last 7 years. Dustin, I guess you're kind of excited about all this stuff. What do you think the Celtics are trying to do here? Were you shocked by this? Where's your head at on it?
I was not shocked by the Danny Ainge news. From what I heard today, people that were close situation kind of felt like he was going to get out at some point recently. And so that's not a surprise, apparently. But he has been there very long, so it's kind of weird to see somebody just kind of dip out like that. What's weird to see is the head coach leaving his position to go take the front office job. I think that kind of says a lot about Brad Stevens. Maybe had lost the locker room or in touch with a couple of those stars on that team. And that's also why they kind of fluttered most of the year and had a very disappointing year, did not improve on the last couple of years. And maybe he just sees it as, hey, before I get fired like next year, why don't I take this front office?
He wasn't going to get fired. The only changes were going to be Ainge. Arlie, were you caught up to date on this? What'd you think about the moves that the Celtics made after a pretty disappointing season?
I think he's still an excellent spot, eye for talent. So him moving to over to player operations is not a bad move in my opinion for him. And I don't see him ever getting fired though as being head coach. So I don't know why he did it, to be honest, because he was solidified in there. I don't think that he was ever going to be really fired unless he had four or five more bad seasons, to be honest.
He wasn't going to get fired. I think what I've heard today is burnout, that these last three seasons have just been a lot to deal with. You have the Kyrie Irving seasons that were really difficult to handle. Then you have last year's COVID season, which, anybody involved has said it's been pretty taxing on them. And of course the Celtics were one of the last four teams remaining, so they were in the bubble for a long time. Then you turn around and you have to start this season right quick. And of course, this season's been a season from hell for them. So,
yeah,
I think what I've heard is burnout, and I think it makes sense. But it's not an easy position he's going to, and it's not going to take any of the pressure off of him, because now he's got to figure out how to turn a roster that has two young superstars on it into a team that's not bounced in the first round of the playoffs.
And I feel like a lot of those front office positions are almost, if you're a good head coach, then if you're kind of comparing the two, the front office position has more of a rotating door risk than the head coach would.
Yeah, it can, because
figure out what head coach he wants to fill that position. But I would look for them to be very patient with that move.
Oh yeah.
Find the right fit.
Move I heard, I was listening to Bill Simmons and Ryan Russillo and them talk about it, because obviously Bill Simmons is a huge Celtics fan, so they had an emergency pod today, and the name that they were kind of tossing around was Chauncey Billups.
Yeah,
and I would freaking love that for them. That would be a great hire.
That would be a phenomenal hire. I would love to see that.
It's interesting. It's an interesting move for Stevens. He's never, I guess you can take your college kind of recruiting experience to this when you're looking at talent and trying to figure out who's your picks are going to be in the draft.
Yeah.
But, he's got his work cut out for him. Boston is not an easy place to be. Fans get pretty unruly there. They do love him. The front office loves him. So he'll have some room to work, but you've got time, windows close quick, and you've got two really, really good, really, really young players right now, and it's time to capitalize on that. And they've got some bad contracts on that team that they got to get rid of, Kimba.
Subtle. Random out there. Do y'all think the punishment was hard enough on the fan that threw the water bottle at Kyrie?
Well, so I was going to talk about that after we kind of get through the playoffs, because there's a lot of incidents. And so I wanted to round that all about in one little bit after we kind of get through all the other stuff that's happened.
We can touch back on it. As far as the Nets go, though, I will say I'm not surprised that they're winning like this. I just still don't like how few games they played throughout the season. And I still don't think that they're deserving of this at all.
Well, let's get into it. The Knicks and Hawks and the Wizards and Sixers are currently playing. And I really feel like those are pretty uninteresting series the way they played out so far. So let's just get right into the second round here matchup that I think everybody is super excited for. And that's going to be the Milwaukee Bucks and the Brooklyn Nets. I think it's an awesome series. I've got some stuff for you guys. So these teams have combined for 238.7 points per game during the regular season. That's tied for the most between two teams in the past 50 years to, who have played in a playoff matchup together. So these offenses have been killing it this season. Giannis this year, when he's playing the Nets, he is averaging 39.7 points, 10.7 rebounds, 5 assists a game against the Nets. That's some pretty good numbers, if you ask me. That's a lot. That's a lot. And the Nets trio so far this postseason has averaged 85.2 points per game, which is the most by any playoff by any trio in a playoff series. So we've got two pretty gifted offenses here. We've got a dominant player in Giannis who can have his way with this Nets team. And we have a Nets trio who can have their way with just about any team. I feel like this is a super toss-up game seven series, just haymakers left and right. Dustin, where are your thoughts at on this series? Your Nets against my Milwaukee Bucks.
Yeah, I think it'll come down to if the Nets want to play enough defense in this series. We know the Bucks can play some defense. They've shown that over the last couple of years. And they've retooled the team to be better around Giannis. So this is what they want. They're going to get probably the best team coming out of the East right now. So, yeah, I think it'll be game seven. And who knows? I don't know. We'll see who can stay healthy throughout this series.
Yeah, I think that's a key thing. Arlie, where's your head at? Bucks, Giannis, the trio of the Nets. Where are you thinking this series goes?
I mean, we're going to basically see night after night 140 plus to 130 plus games. It's going to be literally it's going to be just nonstop scoring. So it's literally just who misses less. Is gonna win this game. It's not gonna be who makes the most blocks, who makes the better stops. Like I'd give a slight defensive edge to Milwaukee in this, but I don't think that if the big three from Brooklyn is gonna be on fire, I don't think that Milwaukee can stop it. So this is gonna go. I think it's gonna go game seven, and I wouldn't be surprised if that game seven is 140 to 135, something silly like that.
Yeah.
I think the trio stops here. I think the Bucks take this series. I think if there's any team that's going to beat the Nets this year, the Bucks are my pick for it because of Giannis and the Nets have really nobody who can guard him or stop him. And you look at that Celtics series, like Tristan Thompson was getting boards left and right. Like, come on, Tristan Thompson's washed and he's trash now. So Giannis is going to have a field day with them. Brooke Lopez is going to be a problem for them. And then Drew Holiday is going to be the X factor for me in this because I think his defense, if he's able to slow James Harden or Kyrie Irving down, like depending on the game, that's going to be really beneficial. And then you've got other really good defenders like Giannis, PJ Tucker, other guys out there that you can just keep throwing bodies at KD and Harden and Kyrie. And a lot of these guys can switch. Their length is going to be a problem. And if this is a series that they're going to lose, I think this is going to be it.
Yeah, big time.
So it's going to be an exciting series. I really hope this one gives us seven games. The East has been kind of boring so far. We haven't really had anything good series-wise. We thought the Knicks and Hawks was going to be a good series, but the Hawks have kind of taken care of the Knicks relatively quickly. And so that kind of leaves us kind of boring. The Sixers lose Joel Embiid, and that kind of makes their run interesting. I think that only makes it interesting in the second round, though, for them.
Who are they playing next round?
That would be the winner. So probably they would play the Hawks.
Probably Hawks. I still think that they'd be okay there. I think that they make it to the championship, even without Joel Embiid, or if he's like at half health. I still think they're a lot better roster than the Hawks. They're going to win this game against the Wizards. Like, I don't doubt that at all. They're up by 6 in the third. But I think that that's going to be okay series. That's definitely not the steak of the meal. It's definitely this Nets and Brooks game, or this Nets Bucks, blah blah blah.
Yeah, the Hawks will be interesting. I think they definitely surprised me. I didn't realize, like, they have some good players, and I thought the Knicks would be more of a challenge. I thought the Knicks would actually win the series, and, you know, the Hawks have just kind of had their way with them. The only reason the Knicks have won a game, I think, is because they had a home court game that was going wild. And they
Well, it's like I said to start, like, this is what Tom Thibodeau teams do. They play super hard all year, and they don't have anywhere else to go. They don't have anywhere else up to go. Like, and now all of a sudden, Julius Randle doesn't know how to deal with a double team and can't make shots, and like, they can't crank it up to another volume and level. Like, this is what
his team and their offense is trash. Their offense is trash.
It is.
And so, yeah, I really think, you know, even if they win tonight, I don't really think they have a shot. I think it's shaping up to be Sixers Hawks, which, I mean, we can talk about it more once that series probably gets started, because we got to shift our focus to the Western Conference, and we're going to lead it off with Dame Time, because last night was an all-time performance by Dame Lillard. They lost the game because his teammates decided that they weren't going to show up for him in the second half and overtime. And it was very frustrating for Dame. I can only imagine how frustrating that must have been. Let's just talk about Dame's night last night. So if you weren't aware, Dame Lillard went nuclear. He hit a game-saving shot at the end of regulation, hit three incredible threes in overtime to send him to a second overtime. And then the rest of his teammates decided that they were going to miss every single shot. Some stats from last night on Dame Lillard. He is the first player in NBA history with 50 points, 10 assists, and 10 three-pointers in a game in the regular season or playoffs. So he's the first to ever do that.
Jesus.
He also only had one turnover in his 51 minutes of play. That's another just incredible thing, because the ball's in his hands the whole time. He had a playoff record, 12 threes. And in overtime and double overtime, he had 17 points on 6 of 8 shooting, while the rest of the Blazers combined for 2 points on 1 of 19 shooting. So that really was the nail in the coffin for them down the stretch. It was an incredible performance, though. Dame had Twitter going wild. He had KD tweeting out God mode. He had everybody. He's they lose this game, but he's the hero of the game, even though they don't win. There's the epic moment where he finally misses a shot in a double overtime, and they get a glimpse of Austin Rivers, and he's like thanking God that Dame Lillard missed. And I was like, that's the most accurate, honest thing I think I've ever seen somebody do on a basketball court. Dustin, you went to bed earlier.
Hey, I got a lot of things going on. I had to get up at 6 o'clock this morning. All right?
Are you regretting that decision?
No, because it went to double overtime and it went to bed forever. Then I would have been hyped up about it. But what a performance. I've heard people talking today, calling it like one of the best basketball single performances ever. Like, ridiculous. And the fact that his teammates didn't show up for him to help him out. Very disappointed. You could kind of see it in his face in the post game. Like, he basically wanted to say, this is bullshit.
Like, I wouldn't blame him. I wouldn't blame him. I mean,
they can't help me out a little bit.
You look down the stretch. He has a really nice, you know, Dame drops off a really easy pass to Covington, who has a clear path to the basket. And all he has to do is lay it up. He tries to drop the hammer instead and botches the dunk. And then later on, Dame gets a steal, comes down, and kicks it to McCollum, who steps out of bounds.
And Dame so it's wasn't just like, hitting open threes. He was hitting stupid step backs.
Every one of them was a ridiculous step back.
Ridiculous every time.
I was like FaceTiming my girlfriend, and I kept making like these wild reactions with shots. And I was like, it can't get harder than that shot.
That whole game was wild, though.
And then bank shot from like the logo. You're like, holy shit, what is happening? It was like, it was one of the most absurd performances I've seen. Arlie, did you get to watch it? Did you catch the highlights? What did you take in this game?
I watched it all the way until probably about. I had some other stuff that I had to take care of last night. So I saw that the Nuggets were up by about 3. And so then I was like, oh, okay, so that's probably how this is going to ride out. But I'm an idiot and forgot that Damian Lillard was on the opposite fucking end of the field, or on the opposite end of the court, sorry. And so I should have stuck around and watched that one. I caught the highlights afterwards after I found out that he had dropped 55. But, I mean, great game. Still, you got to put a little bit of blame on Dame. He had the opportunity to leave Portland, I think, right? And he, like,
what blame on Dame?
Hold on, he chose to stay in that and be the big fish there. Did he not?
Yeah, because they could pay him. They pay him more money, and he didn't want to go ring chase or anything like that. He wanted to be loyal to his city, and he played there. I don't think that's any fault to him. I think it's more of an organizational fault that they can't put together a team that competes with them, or can compete with them. It's one of the worst defensive teams in NBA history.
It's a small market team.
And they make trades. Yeah.
So, but, like, if we're looking at the
so you're going to fault him for not doing, like, the thing that we criticize all these other athletes for. No. Is now you're saying that Dame Lillard
I didn't say that. I just said that it sucks that he's in this situation. But
then why are you? You said it's his fault, though.
To some degree, you do. You have your choices that you make. He chose to stay there, and he doesn't have teammates to back him up. He had a phenomenal performance, and he's doing everything that he can to make this a series and do well with it. But I mean, you choose to play in the small market, don't you? I don't know. But anyways,
you choose to play in the small market like Giannis did, and then your team goes and trades for Drew Holiday and, you know, makes,
oh yeah,
no, you know, it, goes it, and pays the, PJ the Tucker and all this stuff. And
front office isn't without,
we're talking about the Bucks.
But
that's not really, I don't think that's Dame's fault. You know, he did everything he could last night. Nobody's going to blame that on Dame Lillard.
But if we're talking about the outcome of this, if we're talking about the outcome of this, Denver Nuggets are obviously a little bit more well-rounded. They have a little bit of
Market team too, though.
Yeah,
they're a homegrown team too. They're the they're exactly like they are. They're a homegrown team. Drafted Jokic, drafted Michael Porter Jr., drafted Jamal Murray. Everybody on their team's drafted. They have the same exact style as the Blazers are. They are. They're similar. They're a small market team. They're not getting free agents to go there. The last free agent they got there was like Paul Millsap. So they have to build the same way. Their organization is built a little bit better, but.
Better front off. Either way, right now they're a little bit more well-rounded. It sucks that Damon ended up losing this. He is a phenomenal player, but I'm not too surprised about the outcome on this.
I was a little surprised that Mike Malone didn't have the Nuggets foul Dame Lillard up by 3 with 10 seconds left. You know, let the one of the greatest clutch time shooters we've seen in the last all time
foul because he'll get a shot off still.
Yeah, I don't know. Refs are pretty picky on that. Like,
I know, but
they call everything on the floor when you're trying to get a shot off, but it's always continuation when you're driving to the basket. You could be like half court, get fouled, take 10 steps and get a layup, and they'll be like, and one. But if you catch the ball and take a dribble and come up into your motion, it's on the floor.
Yeah.
Still, how do you not foul that? At least try to. It was so dumb to me that they just let him take a 3. But yeah, incredible game. Dave gave it his all. You know, you just wish that some of his teammates could have made at least one more bucket for him there.
What did they do? Let's look. Got it right here. Yeah, he didn't have anybody break over 20.
Yeah, I already said that they only had 1 of 19 shooting and 2 points in the overtimes. But that game was going, it took center stage while another game was going last night. That game fell to the wayside pretty early into the first quarter. The Lakers decided that they're going to pack it up for game five and put all their money on game six back in Los Angeles. I didn't watch really much of that game. I watched the first quarter, saw it was over, switched over to watch Dame's incredible performance. For me, as the resident LeBron fan, this wasn't super shocking to me. I think when AD came out that he wasn't going to play, I was already kind of chalking this up as a loss.
Yep.
LeBron isn't the guy that he was a couple years ago where he could just take these washed dudes on his team to just a win over a very, very good Suns team. Like, the Suns team is really dang good. They were hitting shots, and LeBron's passing it to a wide open Alex Caruso, who clanks it off the rim, and passing it out to Markieff Morris, who clanks it off the rim, and Kyle Kuzma, who hasn't made a three, I think, this whole series. So I think he decided, oh, my team sucks tonight. I think I'm just going to get ready and hope AD's back for game six. That's our only shot.
Will he be back? Because if he's not back, they don't have AD. They're not winning this. And that'll be LeBron's first ever first round exit of the playoffs.
And yeah, so that was actually the first time he's ever lost two games in a row in the first round.
Yes.
And, I mean, they also they need AD to come back strong, too, though, because that was the main deal when that first – in that game one loss was AD was just kind of looking flat-footed. And so it wasn't until game two when he decided, oh, yeah, I got to try in this first round. And
yeah, when he asserted himself, that series looked over.
Completely.
You know, the Lakers won games two and three pretty handily. They were winning pretty handily in game four. AD goes down, and then all of a sudden this whole series – just flips just like that. And now, you know, Lakers on the brink of elimination.
Yeah.
Of course, LeBron's always been really good in elimination games. He averages the most points in elimination games with 33.7 per game when facing elimination. I got to say, I think it's a wrap for the Lakers this year. I think they maybe pull off game six, but I do not see them winning game seven in Phoenix if Anthony Davis isn't close to what he was supposed to be.
Sorry, that was old. I don't know why that started playing there. My bad, man.
Ouch.
Yeah, that was loud. No, so you were saying you see game six, but not game seven?
Yeah, I think. Yeah, I don't see them winning the series all of a sudden. The Suns have looked really good. Chris Paul.
Yeah.
Been playing well. Devin Booker's been lights out. They have dudes who actually can make open threes. DeAndre Ayton has made Andre Drummond his little bitch. I hate Andre Drummond, and I would actually be okay with never having to watch him play basketball again. So it's just really
strong. Those are strong feelings.
He's terrible, and the freaking Lakers keep running him out there like he's going to make a difference. Meanwhile, DeAndre Ayton's just dunking all over him.
Yeah.
Like, Drummond will put up numbers just because he's big and will find himself with a rebound and a putback here and there, but dude's trash.
Yeah. I mean, he's their backup in the paint, realistically. The guy controlling around the rim should be AD. But, I don't know. I mean, do you think LeBron might still have any sort of that juice whenever what was it? Whenever that first year that the Warriors won their championship, where LeBron was literally just every single night scoring heavy.
Dude, I don't think he has that in him.
Right?
Not that much volume.
Because that he was that left, we've that seen him do it, volume. But can he do it here?
No, because at least then. No, because none of these dudes right now are playing good. Like, Kyle Kuzma is not playing good. KCP's not playing good.
Yeah.
Dennis Schroeder was terrible last night. Like, he needs somebody to step up and kind of support him and be able to make shots when he kicks the ball to you. And right now, everybody's missing it. And, you know, he's having to work extra hard because of his ankle and because he's not 100% himself. And so it's just too much for him. He needs Anthony Davis there to take some of that pressure off of him. And, you know, when the AD's not there, who's going to step up. And right now you're asking Markieff Morris to like fill in his spot, or you're asking Kyle Kuzma to do it. Like, that's a significant drop off. And none of these roster additions that they made are any good. Like,
no,
I think, you know, Montrezl Harrell can't even play. And Schroeder is, he has a night that's really good. And you're like, oh, maybe he's turning. And then he goes and has last night for you. So yeah. I don't know. It's just too much. And they're getting destroyed by campaign of all freaking people. Campaign. Like, man, I don't see it. I still think he could put up a hero LeBron performance and then them lose, just because I think the Suns are actually a really dang good basketball team.
I mean, that too, though. They are a phenomenal basketball team all around. You know what it feels like? It's like they're trying to create the iPhone killer, like around the league. Like, everybody just wants to beat LeBron. And so, like, I'm not too surprised that, well, I don't want to say I'm not too surprised, because I did have the Lakers winning this one, obviously, but with AD out, their chances diminish. And with LeBron with a hurt ankle, their chances diminish more. And without him having support, they diminish even more. So it's like, it's not looking in his favor. I don't know.
No, if you'd have told me going in that AD was going to get hurt, which I should have known. I mean, the dude can't get hurt without running down up and down the court. Like, he's always got something. And so I think I got really confident after game three, after they dominated game three. I was like, oh, yeah, this is over. This series is a wrap. But AD gets hurt again, and, you know, everything shifted. And now we're looking at an early playoff exit for LeBron, which hasn't happened in a very, very long time. But another series that flipped the script on us as of last time that we talked, we were basically sending the Clippers on their way. We were so excited for it. And since then, it feels the complete opposite now. It feels like we're sending the Mavs on their way home, and the Clippers have seized control of the series. They have outscored the Mavericks 211 to 159 since the Mavs held a 30-11 lead in game three. And I'm texting, it's a wrap. It's a wrap. Vince Carter meme. I'm like, this series is over. The Clippers turned it up a notch. And another stat that has a lot to do with it: the Mavs offensive rating in games one and two was 128.3. In games three and four, 105. That's a significant drop. So they were having an incredible offensive performance in game one and two, and then they've been under average in games three and four. That'll even up a series really quick. And what really did it is the Clippers went small. They decided that they were not going to play Zubac that much, and then they went with a smaller lineup, and that really did help their offense out, gave Kawhi more room to work with. He's been amazing in this series, and the NBA regular season's best three-point shooting team has come alive from beyond the arc. That's what's propelled the Clippers. Dustin, you look disappointed over there. Are you alarmed? Do you think the Mavs have a chance to keep this a series, or do you think it's a wrap now all of a sudden? Where are you sitting?
No, I think I was more alarmed at games one and two and the first part of game three at how well they were playing and looking. And I think we've come back down to earth and we have the two teams we thought we would get. So I don't think it's that big of a shock. Now, it is a shock that they blew game three, especially that first quarter like they did. And this just shows that they have nobody but Luka.
Yep.
And it's horrible.
And he's hurt.
Trash. Now Luka has like a gimpy neck arm situation, whatever that is. Like, he's not going to be full strength. And so that's going to take just a huge hit out of the Mavericks. Cause I mean, Tim Hardaway Jr. is a good scoring option when you have Luka on the floor, but without him, he has trouble getting open and getting good shots. So it's like, and then after that, there's nobody. Porzingis is garbage out there, and they're undersized. They're still getting out rebounded. There's not much of a hope out there unless Luka's going off and handling things.
Yeah.
And as soon as he goes off the floor, it's like, well, here comes a run by the other team. We can't manage it.
I think that's how it started too. Like the turnaround was whenever they took Luka off the floor while he was hot, and they sat him for what was it, 4 minutes total?
Three minutes. But I mean, that's been the game plan.
But six. As soon as they sat him, Clippers came storming back, and that was. I don't know.
Arlie, as a kind of our resident Clipper hater over here, and also adopted Mavs fan for the series, just because you hate the Clippers, where do you lie on this outcome? I know you were pretty happy last episode, and then now this. So, are you doing 180? Are you?
No, that this I still believe. I still want Dallas to pull this off, but I don't think they can. The end of it is, and we said this kind of, and I mean, we said this last week. I said it last week, is that it was disappointing how bad these Clippers looked. They have the star power. They have the defense. That's supposed to be the difference maker in these series. And as you've pointed out, they have some of the best 3-point shooting in the league. And yet they were getting taken to school by the Dallas Mavericks, and really one player from the Dallas Mavericks. And so I would love to see Dallas knock them out of this and to be done with them and to have their methodologies proven to be, I guess, unrewarding. But that's not going to be the case here. I think the Clippers found their rhythm, and I think that they're going to take the series in the next two games straight. Yeah. Unfortunately,
it's starting to look like my Luka take is not going to prevail. As soon as I said it, he gets hurt, and then the opposite has happened. So maybe we have like a little bit of a curse here. Who knows?
Tailgate
curse. But I did text y'all that this series is a wrap, and I think right after that, the whole series changed.
So it was your fault.
Yeah, I mean, I'll take the blame for it. If so, I think I texted Dustin last night that the Nuggets game was a wrap when the Nuggets were up like by 20-something, and then, of course, the Blazers came back. So maybe I just should quit texting that it's a wrap. So should have texted it last night about the Lakers, but I did not.
That would
not happen. The only other season or series that is still going on is the Jazz and the Grizzlies. It's had some entertaining games, but it's gone about as I think everybody expected. After the Grizzlies took game one, the Jazz have handled their business, and they are a game away from knocking the Grizzle out of the playoffs. They are looking to play the Clippers-Mavs winner in the next round, which will be a pretty entertaining series. We'll talk about that more next week. But one thing I wanted to get to before we wrap up our NBA playoff talk, and Arlie kind of got to it a little bit earlier, is just what the fuck is going on with fans this year? Bro. All of a sudden, you're letting them back in the stadium, and all these people are going crazy, throwing popcorn, throwing water bottles, spitting on people, pouring beer on people. Us here in Texas, we've been at games for a while now. We've been going into sports this whole time. So I think we're well acquainted with how it has, you know, what we're supposed to do, the etiquette of it. Are these people really just that dumb, or are they like, is it just they've been locked up? What do y'all think it is? Do you think they're, it's been embarrassing, I think, for fans in general that we're having so many of these instances happen every game.
Think about like the repercussions of this really is for example, the Boston fan needs to get his ass whooped on top of the fines. Like somebody needs to lay that dude fucking out, because like, here's the repercussions is the NBA at some point eventually is going to have to react to this, right? They're going to have to do something. And so what's going to happen is that they're going to create a barrier or some kind of distance in between the players and the fans. And yeah, it's one in like 10,000 fans that does something like that, but it doesn't matter. And so like,
it's always just one.
Yeah. And so like, what's going to end up happening is you're going to end up basically with basketball games of people having to sit. What, how far is the NFL sideline to the fans most of the time? About 30 yards, Dustin?
No, it's probably, It's 15 to 20, depending on what stadium you're in. It's a lot closer than you think, but there's a decent.
It's a good distance, I mean, though. And so, like, the NBA is going to have to react.
NBA is way, way, way closer. Probably, I've always said it's too close. I need to back it up a few rows. But
yep.
Yeah, but, like, I always thought it's the weirdest thing ever that you can be watching an NBA game and there's the bench, and right next to the bench are fans sitting right there. Yeah. Like, that's the dumbest thing I've ever seen.
There needs to be a clear separation in between the two, and I think that's where it starts, because these fans, if they're getting that familiar, if they're getting that comfortable with players, and they don't know them, because they don't know them. The fans do not know them. You don't actually know Kyrie. I'm sorry, random Boston dickhead, but, like, you don't get to throw that water bottle. You don't. And
now we know, because the NBA has banned these fans for life, so they know that that is the punishment, right? Is that you're going to be banned, and they still fucking do it.
Yeah, like, they don't care. That's not enough. No, you need to. Unfortunately, you need to. It's the rest of the fan base that's going to get punished out of this, and I mean, rightfully so, because the masses, even though it's only one dickhead in the crowd, have to pay the penalty for it.
Yeah, but one dickhead represents a whole.
Yeah.
A whole fan base, you know, and you threw it at the one player that you couldn't there, Kyrie. And we get the pass. We understand it's a rocky road, but you just can't do that. You can't do that, especially when he came into there saying, I hope they behave themselves. And then you follow it up with throwing a water bottle at him. I mean, it's just embarrassing, man. And then he had a fan run onto the court the other night in a game. I saw it's that. Like, what the fuck he are we doing,
tried
man?
Tried to touch the backboard, and then he got tackled by security. Although,
yeah.
Hold on. All right. Real quick. Where do we rate the tackle 1 to 10?
Tackle was great. The touch of the back was pretty, very terrible. Unathletic.
Yeah. No. But the security guard that did the tackle, I give him a 9.5 out of 10. It was a solid tackle. He got him on the first try, straight to the ground.
Dwight Howard was just like, "The fuck you doing, bro?" But yeah, these fans are crazy, man. They need a. Yeah, I don't really know what the fix is on it, other than like separating them further from the court, or I don't really know. But I mean, I agree with all the players' sentiments on it. Is like they're kind of treating them like zoo animals, and you know, these are humans.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, and you know, it's a shame. I really think that you know, you let fans back in the stadium, and this is how they act. I really wish that they could behave themselves a lot better. I've been enjoying watching the games and hearing the crowd, and it just sucks to have that, you know, at the end of the game. Just come on, go enjoy. I'm as crazy a fan as there is out there, believe me, but I'll never throw popcorn at a player or something like that. I always still respect the players. You know, I might cuss at them from afar, or cuss at certain head coaches that might be coming back, but
certain black, you know, that's and white colored extent people.
Yeah.
Black and white jersey wearing people.
So it's all about having fun. We get it. But at the end of the day, there's a line. And, you know, when you get a player involved, like maybe Ron Artest wasn't necessarily wrong in what he did so many years ago.
Oh, my God. The rumble. Went.
You know, you hear a lot of players just saying, like, hey, give us a chance, man, and see what happens. Like, I heard somebody on a podcast talking. You throw Russell Westbrook with that fan that poured popcorn on him. Guarantee that guy's never pouring popcorn on anybody again.
Oh, man. I think people have it in their head that these are not superior athletes. And I, for one, do not want Kyrie to punch me in the face by any means. Because you know that if he did rear back and try and jack you once in the jaw, You're either going to sleep right there, or you're going to get your jaw wired.
Because Kyrie's a smaller NBA player, and he's still bigger than most of us.
How tall is Kyrie? What, 6'4", 6'3"?
I think he's like 6'1", or 6'2", but I mean, still
Steph is 6'3", isn't he?
Yeah, something like that.
They're about
maybe
the same size.
Maybe he is 6'3". I don't know his exact size, but he's considered a smaller person in the NBA, and that dude's still going to tower over all these dudes. Yeah,
like, up here to me, like, hey, my bad, dude. Like, I'll talk trash. I'm all for talking trash. I'm all for fanhood.
Yeah.
I'm all for that. Absolutely 100% behind it. It's conducting yourself in an adult-like manner and in a respectful manner. I don't care who that is. It's another human being, but they're trying to put on a show for you. This is entertainment. and you taking this personally makes you the dickhead. Like, yeah. I really hope that that guy gets his ass whooped, because what might happen as a result of this? It's frustrating, dude.
It's still a long ways before anything actually changes because of it. But yeah, so just wanted to bring that up. Crazy fans out there, behave yourselves, people. If you're at a sporting event, be a normal freaking person, man. Yeah. Drink some beers, have some fun, yell, holler, cuss if you want to, boo the refs, especially the refs. But let's leave the throwing of things and spitting of things and all of that out of it. Let's just have a good time.
Yeah.
Welcome back to stadiums. Enjoy it. You crazy ass people. Right. Yeah.
Not much else we can really do from this seat besides complain too.
But that's it for this week's NBA playoff check-in. Check in with us next week as we'll be diving into the second round. We'll have all those matchups probably ongoing by the time we pick up next Wednesday. So a lot of good matchups that we're going to be having a lot of good times talking about.
Oh, next week is going to be good. Definitely something to look forward to. Mainly that Bucks-Nets round, but the West is going to be on the top end. The top end of the West is stacked. Yeah. Literally anybody in the top four, I think, is – wouldn't be a surprise to see as an NBA champion this year.
Yeah, I think if the Lakers get bounced, I will shift my fan focus to the Suns. I'll shift it to the Suns.
I'm with you on that. I'm a CP fan. Obviously, I got a lot of respect for him as an athlete, as a person off the field or off the court. I keep saying field, and it just fuck. Anyways,
so ready for football,
right? Well, football. I've been watching soccer. It's just anyways. So jumping forward, obviously a lot of good NBA action coming around later tonight. We do have the game six. No, sorry, game five. Is it game five for tonight for Knicks and or not Knicks?
Clippers, Mavs, game five tonight. Yeah.
So that's coming around tonight. I think that starts in about 30 minutes. So definitely something to keep an eye out. See if Luka could maybe turn this around. But that is going to wrap up our NBA playoff discussion for the week. We'll obviously have plenty more for you going into next week. So we're going to go ahead and kick this over into the shot bets for this last week. We kick it off with the Knicks and Hawks. This is Tailgate Talk Shot Bets.
There we go.
We're going streaking!
I feel like sometimes it's trying to find that file and it's just like, was it my turn? Okay, now. All right. So first game, first shot bit of last week. We announced it on the podcast live as well as on the Twitch live was going to be the Knicks versus the Hawks. Hawks took game three for the third straight game. We all actually we're on a bit of a sweep where we brought the brooms out. All three of us picked the Hawks in that game and all three of us end up winning that shot bet. So if you did end up taking the Knicks, if you're trying to ride the train with the Knicks for some reason, I don't know why you still would, honestly, because I'm sorry, they're just not enough to make it in these playoffs. Then you do owe us a shot, so make sure you do send that to us on social medias. The second game that we're going to be looking at, which was announced on social media from our accounts, was the Blazers versus the Nuggets. Where'd it go?
Oh well. That was that game we talked about a lot earlier last night.
We talked quite a bit about it just now. That was the overtime game with Dame scoring 55 and the Nuggets kind of holding on to double overtime victory. The Nuggets end up winning this one. Brooks actually got to cast his vote. I put mine on Instagram and didn't read the whole message. Go ahead. Yeah, like you've heard me once pull for the Blazers in this series, but anyways, I'll take a consolation shot. I don't care.
And we were just curious because we didn't post it, so we never knew if you actually voted or anything, or if you got it in time.
No, we're gonna do this consolation shot.
Since I dipped out at the end of the third quarter. And then I woke up this morning and all the Twitter was just about Dame Willard. I was like, oh, the Blazers definitely won.
Nope.
All right. I had to go to the ESPN app and look for the game to find out the final score. That's how much of a great game it was. I just assumed that he had won the game for him. And no, not the case.
So Nuggets end up taking the win on that one.
Paying your shot off.
Dustin does have a shot for this one.
No, I'm taking a little bit of alcohol hiatus.
Okay.
I'll make those up when I come back around to it.
Wait, how long is this hiatus?
I don't know.
Did we go a little bit too hard the last couple weeks? Too many?
No.
Because we had no shot bets to be paid. You just decided to just make up for it somewhere else?
I definitely did that.
I did too. Oh, yeah, that's right. You went up to go visit last weekend. Shit. Oh, man. We'll talk more later. Anyways, so this week's shot bets, we only have one to start off with. We're going to be doing the similar format that we did for last week. We're going to be announcing just the first game so far to start. The Milwaukee Bucks versus the Brooklyn Nets on game one this Saturday. Be on the lookout for it. We'll be probably posting to where you can get your vote in on socials, probably Friday night at some point. That way you got the whole bit of Friday at the end and all day Saturday to get your vote in. So that will be our first shot bet. As far as the second shot bet goes, that will be announced on social medias, and I will make sure to get my on Twitter this time.
Twitter or Insta, just a little retweet or post it on your story. Tell people who you're taking.
Yeah,
way the world knows.
I gotta put myself out there more accountable for the shot or the picks that I make. I'm with you. I took my consolation shot. I didn't have proof that I was pulling for Nuggets, even though I was, but it's fine. I thought I was at two shots.
Well, that third one was added for
the
your
Nuggets
consolation.
Thing.
For your, okay, yeah, okay, for the
okay.
Nuggets thing.
Okay, okay. So I'm at two shots. Dustin is for the first time in quite a while gonna hold on to the shot debt. Yeah. But he will pay that back at some future point.
Three straight weeks.
I got a birthday coming up.
Three straight weeks with no shots, baby. Boom. But we haven't picked our Nets Bucks game. So
we'll get back to that. What was I gonna say? Dang it, I lost my train of thought on that. All right. Well, Brooks has been a monster lately. So whatever he picks on this Brooks Nets game, I'd probably ride that one with him if I were you listening. We'll go ahead and save him for last, just that way me and Dustin don't get that option.
Thank you, I appreciate it.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, I know Dustin's train. No, I know who Dustin's voting for. Anyways, I'm gonna be pulling for the Bucks on this one. That's gonna be my shot bet, for this week in between the Milwaukee Bucks and Brooklyn Nets. Dustin, who is going to be your shot bet pick for that game?
Still rolling with my Nets.
Okay. All right. So. On the wind train, Brooks, who are you taking? Which one of us are you going to bless with your vote?
This is probably where it's going to stop. I keep debating because I'm like, are the Nets going to come out just firing and shut them down? Or are the Bucks going to surprise us and show that dominance they did against the Heat and take game one? And that's what I'm going to go with. I picked the Bucks to win the series, and I think the only way to do it is by stealing one of two in the first two games. I'm going to say they start the series off with a dub on Saturday, going Milwaukee Bucks game one. Giannis is going to drop like 50 points on that weak Brooklyn D.
50?
Let's go.
Nah,
probably not 50.
Oh, I was like, damn. All right. I haven't seen
him. If he scores 50, that'll be cool.
That would be great.
Heard it here first.
All right, so summarizing, I guess this past week, I'm at two shots. Dustin's at one. Dustin will be rolling those over on the next week, or maybe this weekend. Who knows? Maybe somebody will talk him out of it. We'll see. Actually, no, he's pretty good normally. Whenever he doesn't want to drink alcohol, but anybody else owing us a shot bet, make sure you do send us or tag us in those videos or photos or. Literally, whatever. Any way that you want to get those to us, just send us your shot. We're doing this to have some fun. We have fun amongst each other with it because we get to kind of put something on the line and make these games kind of mean a little bit of something. But we'd also love it if y'all were able to join us on that one. So I think that's going to kind of wrap up the show for us this week. You know, little bit quicker episode, I think. We still talked for quite a while, though. NBA was a long, good discussion. I enjoyed that. But final shots for the week. Let's go ahead and throw this over to Dustin. What do you have for us on the final shot for this week for you?
You can tell by my shirt. I want to tag team this one with Brooks. I know he already called it, but I'm jumping in with him. So, Brooks, take it away with some Coach K.
You're the wearing the Duke shirt. I'll let you, sir.
Bring out the Duke shirt. Actually, the 2010 national championship shirt, which the John Shire, who is the coach in waiting, was a player on that team and was also a coach for the 2015 national championship team. So kind of cool tie in there. Yeah, Coach K announced his retirement today from Duke in college basketball, big college basketball news. And especially he's been such a just rock and cornerstone and, I mean, icon in the sport of basketball in general with coaching USA basketball and so many national championships and top five teams and recruiting classes. He kind of adapted his own coaching strategy and philosophy. I mean, he's the number one, has the most wins in men's college basketball history. I mean, the list goes on and on of the great things he's done. He's definitely the best college basketball coach of our era and lifetime, right behind John Wooden. So congrats to him. This next year will be a little farewell tour.
Yep. So that was my final shot as well. Basketball. Had a lot of news break this morning with had the Celtics stuff, and then we had Coach K announcing that this will be his final year. So, he's obviously been the GOAT of college basketball coaching for a long time. He used to do it with four-year seniors, and then when the one-and-done era came about, he did it, and he's been at the top of that. game, of course.
He didn't want to do it at first, but then
he didn't want to do it.
His mind, and he turned around.
Yeah,
but he adapted, and so yeah, he's obviously a coach loved by many. That Duke brotherhood is strong because of their love for that coach, and all he's done for them. And of course, you know, the NBA, a lot of NBA players who got to play under him with the Olympics and stuff, love him to death as well. So just an icon in college basketball, but not only that, in the basketball world. Losing him and then Roy Williams retiring this last year, losing some legends. I'm guessing Boeheim is the next one, and it'll be on to the next young group of coaches that are out there take up those mantles. But
it's not the same without either of those two coaches, honestly, anymore in college basketball. It's weird. It's very weird.
Yeah, it's gonna.
I think with how the landscape of college basketball is shaping, especially the last couple years, and some of these guys' ages, they don't want to deal with as much hassle as it is now. I mean, you gotta recruit a guy and then hope he stays for more than 1 year, and then you gotta, if he does stay more than 1 year, try to recruit him to stay on your own team rather than transfer out.
Now you got to recruit against the possibly going and playing like G League and professional basketball right off the bat. It's just like getting crazier.
Coming out, like, you have so much decent competition now that it's a tough gig. Like, it was already a hard gig. Now it's getting even harder. So
very, very true. I didn't even consider the G League and all that too. Jesus. Yeah. I don't blame him. I don't blame him at all. Either.
Like, he's already done enough.
Yeah.
I mean, he's going to go down, obviously, in College Basketball Hall of Fame, but like, he's already. Okay. Well,
yeah,
either way.
Yeah.
He's going to go down as one of the biggest coaches ever to coach college basketball. And, there's nothing else you can really say. Hats off. We're going to miss him. As far as my final shots go, a short twofer again, the Canadians, you know, trying to kind of talk a little bit of NHL each week since I have a team now. Canadians, so here was the deal. You know how, who was it that lost 3-1 in the NBA playoffs? Or they were up 3-1, sorry.
Clippers.
Yeah. Clippers last year. Sorry. Yeah, Clippers were up last year 3-1, right? And they ended up losing the series. Toronto Maple Leafs went ahead and did the same thing, but the Canadiens were the team to beat them. So they were down 3-1 in this series, ended up winning 3 in a row to move on to the next round to play against Winnipeg. Now they're beating Winnipeg in the end of the third period with a 3-1 lead at this very moment. So definitely excited about that. But the actual news that I do want to talk about is Christian Pulisic. He is on the U.S. men's national soccer team, and he is by far our best player. And, I mean, I'm talking like he has been since his senior year of high school. He's been our best soccer player. Quite literally, he went to go play for a club team over in Europe and flew back for his prom. Like, that's quite literally how good this dude is. And so he plays for Chelsea at the moment out in the EPL. And Chelsea ended up winning the Champions League tournament, which is one of the hardest tournaments. You remember how a couple weeks ago, we were talking about that Super League thing?
Super League.
Yeah. So Super League was a response to some of these top teams not making it deep enough into the Champions League. And that's how important this Champions League is to those people. They were willing to spend millions upon billions of dollars to make their own league versus not making it far enough into this Champions League. So we have an American, we have a United Statesman playing at the highest level possible with one of the best clubs in the entire world. And so he takes home a championship league medal, and they raise that trophy. Congrats to Christian Pulisic. Awesome career.
USA.
Yeah.
USA.
Dude, it's so good to see USA he's soccer.
He's their best player, right?
Oh, yeah. I don't know if I wouldn't – hard to say hands down their best player, but he's on there for 90 minutes plus. He's playing the entire game in any overtime.
So are you a Chelsea fan?
No. I've always been a Manchester United fan personally since, like, the mid-90s.
Going to say Mike Ryan from the Levitard Show does a Chelsea podcast where he is, like, he's very well connected and all that stuff. And so he's a big Chelsea fan. So he was pretty hyped over the weekend. So that's kind of how I was aware of it. He was posting about it all weekend.
Dude, that's cool. It's big news. It's big news for U.S. soccer. I'm pumped to see this. Obviously we have somebody like, cause it was always such a hard time. Whenever Landon Donovan made it to Europe and was playing in the EPL, it was a big deal. Like, what, 10, 15 years ago, everybody was super pumped about that. So to see this guy win in, like, the hardest, in arguably the hardest stage, because there's no nationalism that you have to worry about here. They can pick and choose and develop any roster that they want, and he wins one of the hardest tournaments there are in the world for soccer. We got an American in there, and that's phenomenal. But anyways, that's my final shot. Christian Pulisic is a legend, and he's basically carrying the U.S. men's national team on his back. So, anything else y'all have for this episode, guys?
No, man, I'm good.
I'm good.
Sweet, sweet. Well, everybody out there listening, apparently shout out to West Texas A&M softball for winning a natty. Oh, man.
Yeah, I'm in softball.
Yeah, I just don't like pulling for anybody that has A&M next to their name. No, I'm kidding. So if you are listening, make sure you do subscribe to the podcast. If it is on Spotify or iTunes, in particular iTunes, make sure you give us that 5-star rating as well as drop a review down below. And if you really want to help us out, make sure you head over to Twitter, Instagram, or Facebook and give us a follow. The Twitter account is @tailgate_talks. But as I said earlier in this episode, we are doing a lot more work in regards to the YouTube channel. So make sure you do swing by there. Make sure you do drop a subscribe and ring the bell for us as far as helping that grow. If you do want to follow our personal accounts, make sure you can follow Dustin at DustinWimmer22 on Twitter. Brooks, you can find him at Calvin B. Barrett. Me, you can find me at Blanca, where the L is a 1. And if you have any sort of questions, emails, or any sort of questions, thoughts, or anything that you want to hear us talk about more on the show, make sure you email us at tailgatetalkspod@gmail.com. I think that wraps it up for us this week. And we will catch you guys on next week. Obviously, keep an eye out on all the socials. Look out for all of the postings and get your shot bet votes in. See y'all later. Yep.
Catch y'all at the next tailgate.